Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our weekly mentoring hour. So we thank God for giving us this opportunity to meet up week after week. So even before we could start with the session, request one of us to please lead us in prayer. Can I request Elisha? Can you lead us in prayer, please?
Praying. Our Lord and Master Jesus, we want to thank you and bless you for this day in our lives. We want to thank you for the moments that we are sharing fellowship together. Father, we pray, commit this session into your hands, O God. It is our prayer that, Lord, you come and take absolute control in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, lead and guide us in the name of Jesus. Father, let this moment be a moment of sharing, the sharing of knowledge, the sharing of experiences, and the sharing of blessedness. Father, we pray that, Lord, you grant wisdom and understanding to whatever our faculty will be discussing and sharing with us, and grant us also understanding to comprehend whatever it is shared with us. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. So we keep this time open to all to ask questions, share our thoughts, discuss, or clarify on any topic that's in our mind or we are interested in. So request our students to, you can go ahead, post your questions on chat, or you can also unmute and ask your questions. Anyone, it can be based on your course. The question can be based on your course or any thoughts that you have, you can ask or clarify. Any questions? Sid, John, Elisha, any questions that you would like to ask or clarify? Yes, yes, John. Okay, why did God smite Uzzah even though he was a Levite? Okay. Pastor Nancy, you would like to take this question?
Yes, hi, Diana. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, John, for this question. This is an occurrence in 2 Samuel chapter 6, where we see that the Ark of the Covenant, right, when it was being moved, Uzzah, I think he prevents it from falling by like just using his hand, and he tries to prevent that from happening. But still, we see that God struck Uzzah, verse 7, 2 Samuel chapter 6. I've just opened up that chapter in front of me, so I'm looking at it. Verse 7, Okay, let me read from verse 6. It says, and when they came to Nacon's threshing floor, Uzzah put out his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it, for the oxen stumbled. Then the anger of the Lord was aroused against Uzzah, and God struck him there for his error. And he died there by the ark of God. And David became angry because of the Lord's outbreak against Uzzah, and he called the name of the place Perez Uzzah to this day. Okay, so here, even though what Uzzah did was something to protect the ark, I think it has to do with what God had already instructed his people regarding the way they must treat the ark, John. So, you know, somebody touching it the way Uzzah did, that was not a prescribed way. Okay, and that because of that, it was not honorable, even though he tried to sort of protect the ark, he was not authorized to touch it the way he did. So that was the reason. Yeah, does that help?
Thank you, Pastor Nancy. John, did that answer your question?
To ask a follow-up question to that.
Sure.
So how would that could imply in our lives? Like, what can we take as a lesson from that incident in New Testament?
Okay.
As a New Testament believer.
So what I feel, John, is see the way Jesus said, right? Like in John 4:23, when he speaks to the Samaritan woman, he says that and the worshippers, they will worship him in spirit and in truth. So, you know, our worship, it has to be sincere. It has to honor God, and there has to be that reverence attached to it, and of course, you know, spirit, we rely on God's spirit. We worship the Lord based on the revelation that God's word and spirit give us. So there's all of this that has been laid out for us. So basically what I take away is I take away that, you know, I need to have reverence in my worship, and I need to worship God the way he would like to be worshiped, not the way I want to worship. So simply put, that is what I would take away from it.
Yeah, thank you, Pastor.
Yeah, may sure. I also add to this, Diana?
Yes.
So if you look in Numbers, I'm not really sure of the reference, so I'm just trying to pick that out. There was a stipulation as to how the ark needs to be transported, like Pastor Nancy was saying, that it needed to be carried on poles, and it says that I think the priest who touches it will die. So when you were asking for an application, I think it's about obedience, and we see that, you know, even in the life of David, he had many times had gone back to God looking for instructions on how he needed to do things. But something such as this, you know, he did not pay attention to. And later you see that he actually goes back and reads, gets the law of the Lord read once again. So I think the application for us is obedience, that when there is something that God calls us to obey, we are called for a life of obedience. I think that's the principle we can take away from this also, in addition to what Pastor Nancy said. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Jean. Thank you, Nancy. John, did that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And we have another question from Elisha. How does one get the assurance of salvation? And can you please explain predestination and the role in salvation? Would any of the faculty would like to take up this question, please? Pastor Nancy, you would like to?
Yes, Diana. I'll just add my thoughts, and maybe, you know, Jean, yes, could also pitch in, and yourself as well. How does one get the assurance of salvation? You know, we know that when We believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, you know, as scriptures tell us, you believe in your heart the Lord Jesus and confess him. In this manner we are saved, Romans 10, 9 and 10. And that salvation is by faith through grace. We see that in the book of Ephesians. So salvation is really a matter of faith, Elisha. Okay, putting our faith in the Lord Jesus and then believing that the work that he has done on the cross brings us our rescue, brings us our redemption. And as Jesus taught in John chapter 3, we know he spoke to this learned person called Nicodemus. At that time, I think Nicodemus only wanted to applaud Jesus as another new teacher who brought in new revelation to the house of Israel. But then, Jesus told him, look, what is really important is salvation of Israel. Okay, and that one should be born again. You must be born again. So salvation is the most important thing. And for somebody to be saved, they are saved by faith. So that is the most important ingredient there for one to be saved. Now, what is the assurance of salvation? In New Testament, we see that the moment someone is born again, they are regenerated by the work of the Holy Spirit within them. The Holy Spirit comes to dwell within a believer. So that is like a seal that God puts on the born again believer. So when someone is born again, the assurance that they are born again, you could say that one is by faith, as I already shared. The other is the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, the seal of the Holy Spirit, the inward witness of the Holy Spirit, right? That confirms to us. Now, anyone who's born again in their spirit, they have that confirmation, that assurance that, hey, something has changed. Yeah, we also know, as 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, that anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. Now, this new creation happens in the spirit. It does not necessarily, become evident in our physical body or, even in the soulish person that we are. Maybe we have somewhat the same traits that we had earlier, but in the spirit man, we've become born again. By the Holy Spirit, we have that assurance that, hey, something has changed. Though we cannot put a finger on it in terms of the physical, touch, feel, no. One has the assurance by the Holy Spirit within that I have been born again. Okay, so that is the assurance of salvation. Now, we also say that this spiritual change that has taken place in a person, that is evident through the life of that person as well. So this spiritual change, what can be seen in the life of someone who is born again? They will have that hunger to worship God. They will develop the fruit of the Spirit. They will have the desire to learn more about God through his word, draw near to God. So then you see the fruit as well. One is the changes happen spiritually. The second is, even through the life of that person, it is possible to see, or even for that person himself or herself, for them to see the changes within themselves and have that assurance that, yeah, something has changed. Something has been transformed within me. So, I wanted to share these points. I'm sure my colleagues can add to that. I hope it helps, Elisha. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor Nancy. Elisha, did that answer your question? Okay, great. Thank you. Thank you. We have another question from Herbert. God knew us before we were born. He said the day we would die. It means when one gets sick, there wouldn't be a need of going to hospital, because if it's not yet your time, you won't die. Should I say that if you keep praying to God and doing his work, can he change his mind and maybe extend a lifespan? Or if you don't pray, can he reduce on your set date for your death? Any of our pastors would like to take this question. Herbert's question.
Could you just repeat the question, Diana? Can you just repeat it, please?
Sure, Pastor.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's saying this, like, God knew us before we were born and he has set a date that we would die. So it means if one gets sick, they wouldn't need to go to hospital because it's not yet their time or you won't die. Should I say that? If you keep praying to God and doing his work, can he change his mind and extend our lifespan? Or if we don't pray, can he reduce our lifespan or the set date of our death?
Okay. See, God's will for us is to have a long life. He says, with long life, he will satisfy us. So that's his will. That's his desire and promise. And sickness happens for various reasons. We know the source of sickness is because of the fallen nature, because of the fall. So, that's why sin entered and sickness entered as a result of that. So sickness happens for various reasons. So it could be a direct intervention of the enemy. It could be you know, some limitation.
Pastor, your voice is breaking.
Physically. So for whatever reason, you know, sickness happens, or it could be, you know, us doing something.
Pastor, your voice is breaking. Okay. Sorry about it, the network dropped. Pastor Jakes will join back. In the meanwhile, any of our faculty would like to also answer Herbert's question? Yeah, Pastor Jakes is come.
Oh.
Yes, Pastor.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, your voice was breaking, Pastor, so we couldn't hear you.
Yeah, actually, my internet is a little unstable, so call dropped off. Okay, so yeah, so for all these reasons, we do fall sick. So in this case, you know, when we do fall sick, we need to address the, you know, reason for whatever, you know, it could be for whatever reason we have fallen sick. But the fact is that we do everything in our capacity to get well, you know, what is naturally what we need to do to avoid and to get better, we do that. So so that's the thing, you know. So to answer the question that, you know, God has set, yes, God's will is for us to live a long life, but because of these factors, if we are attacked by symptoms of sickness, then our response should be to respond in faith, ask God for healing, intervene, you know, and do everything possible to not passively receive it and say, okay, God has promised, so nothing will happen, but to stand against it and to deal with it, right? So that is what I just want to place before us. Is that okay, Herbert?
Herbert, did that answer
your question? Yeah, thank you so much, Pastor.
Okay, right. Thanks, Herbert.
Thank you.
Okay, please.
Just to add, you know, one example of God extending life is King Hezekiah, right? So he was about to die, and but when he repented, and this is, we read about this in 2 Kings 20, and you know, and God extended. So he was about to die. And God extended his life by 15 years, healed him through the prophet. And yeah, just to add to what Pastor Jacob already said, you know, God's covenant of healing was accompanied by his instructions for, I mean, when you look at the Old Testament, Exodus 15, 26, he said, I am the Lord who heals you. So he gave his covenant name for healing. but he also gave instructions to the people in the old covenant on how to live as a community and how to live and hygiene laws. So there were community laws and hygiene laws. So the covenant of healing, where God said, I am the Lord who heals you, and I will, the number of your days I will fulfill, was given in the context of the people obeying community laws and hygiene laws, you know, so health and hygiene. So God said, eat this food, don't eat this food. Eat this kind of meat, don't eat this kind of meat. And then when you're living as a community, do this, don't do this. And if you look at the community laws, they're all actually, you know, today we will look back and say, hey, they're all meant to keep people in good health. Or the food that God told them to eat and not to eat was all meant to keep them in good health. So the covenant of healing was given in the context of community laws and hygiene and health and hygiene laws. So they all went together. So nobody could say, you know, the Lord said, the number of your days I will fulfill. He's my healer. And therefore I will be well and I will. No, it was all given in context, you know. So we must understand that God's covenant is given along with his commandments. Our side is to keep the commandments. His side is to keep his covenant. And then that's how we enjoy, you know, in this case, him being the Lord our healer. So we translate that to our day and time. Means we have a responsibility of taking care of our health. God said, yeah, the number of our days is, you know, 70 years and 10. Genesis 6:3 says it's 120 years. So somewhere between 70 to 120 years is what, you know, we can expect to live. He has promised us long life, but all of that promise is given in context with the other commandments, which is we have to take care of our bodies as the temple of God. We have to rest our bodies as we should. So there is that our side of responsibility. And so somebody cannot live recklessly and expect to live a long life. You know, usually that doesn't go hand in hand. So the believer does have a responsibility to think. And then in that context, there is faith. Faith in God and his word comes along with us living, you know, right. I can't live recklessly and then say I have faith. That doesn't go together. You know, that's being irresponsible. It's actually violating God's commandments. So everything has to be held in context. I just add a few thoughts to that. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor. Howard, I hope that helped you and answered your question.
Yeah. So much. Because I was thinking that since he already set your time for death, there is no need of even praising him. There is no need of going to church, because even if it's not yet your time, then you won't die. And even if you go there, but when your time reaches, then you have to die. But I've really picked a leaf. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Herbert. Thank you, Pastor. Answering that question, we have another question from Elisha. Should a minister be angry, and at what time and cost? And there's another question, like, how do you prove that Jesus has sent into heaven? Okay, that's the next question. So the first question of Elisha was, should a minister be angry, and what time and cost? Any of our faculty would like to take this question?
Yes, Diana, I'll just add some things that I know. So Elisha, should a minister be angry? I would say that, you know, anger in itself, it's not, you know, a negative emotion, because even in Ephesians 4:26, we see that, you know, Paul wrote, he said, be angry and do not sin. Don't let the sun go down on your wrath. There is a place for righteous anger when we see things that are not right by God's word, God's standards. It makes us angry, and I think that is natural, and that's how it should be. One incident that we see in the life of Jesus is when, you know, there were money changers in the temple, and he gets so angry, even to the extent that he makes a whip, he turns the tables, and he chases them out because the zeal for God's house. You know, that he is unhappy with the fact that a place of worship is being used for business. So anger, it is a godly emotion, but the most important thing is that it needs to be managed. So instead of being, you know, reactionary, to have a response to the anger is what is important. So should a minister be angry? When a minister sees things that are not right, yes, a minister should be angry, but in the way that one responds to the anger, and you know, the action that comes out of the anger is what is really crucial. And I know there are you know, other scriptures, you know, that say that a minister should correct people with gentleness, one should be teachable. I just don't know the reference, like, you know, like immediately right now, but yeah, I think I'll stop with that. Maybe others could also add to what I have shared. Thank you.
Yeah, just to add to what Pastor Nancy shared, anger is a natural, of course, emotion in response to any kind of injustice or anything you know, that we see that's happening in the world, or maybe even, you know, with ourselves. But how we actually respond to that anger, if we respond in the flesh, then you know, we are going to we're going to commit an act of sin out of the flesh. If we respond to that particular anger in the flesh, but then if we respond as led by the Spirit, then we're going to accomplish the purpose of God in that, you know. Yeah, it is a difficult, it's a challenging thing. It's not impossible, it is definitely challenging. We you know, we see so many things happening, and then we want to respond in anger, we want to speak a harsh word, we want to, you know, kind of respond immediately in anger. But then if we respond in as led by the Spirit of God, and then it will result in a righteous act. It will result in a restoration. It will result in even reclaiming that situation. Yeah, so I just wanted to share that.
Thank you, Pastor Jake. Thank you, Pastor Nancy. And Elisha, did that answer your question? Okay, thank you. Thank you, Elisha. There's another question from Elisha. How do you prove that Jesus ascended into heaven? Any of our pastors?
Yeah, right.
Yes, Pastor.
May I share that? Share a few thoughts on that. So, Elisha, the first evidence the New Testament scripture gives us that Jesus did ascend to the right hand of heaven is the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. So Acts 2:32-33, when Peter is preaching the very first sermon, he says, you know, Jesus has been exalted to the right hand of the Father, and he has poured out the Holy Spirit. You know, and even before Jesus went to heaven, he said, you know, I'm going to go to the Father, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. So the fact that the Holy Spirit, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, is a powerful evidence that Jesus has been exalted at the right hand of the Father. The fact that today, all over the world, people are being baptized in the Holy Spirit, and, you know, on through the centuries and even today. It's just a testimony that Jesus Christ is exalted at the right hand of the Father, as you see people being baptized in the Holy Spirit. And I think maybe a second one that I would, just quickly connected to this is, of course, the signs and wonders that take place in the name of Jesus. And especially deliverance. You know, why do demons listen when we command them in the name of Jesus? I mean, we can use any other name, it's not going to work. But when you command them in the name of Jesus, demons listen. Why? Because the name carries the name of the one who's been exalted. It represents the one who's been exalted at the right hand of the Father. A third powerful witness that Jesus has been glorified is, and of course there will be many testimonies like this, but I would just point to that of the transformation of Saul to Paul. So this is about, let's see, AD 30. So this is about, you know, approximately 10 years after the resurrection. So Jesus ascended around AD 30. The church was born, the Holy Spirit was poured out. About 10 years later, we read about Saul, 8 to 10 years later, we read about Saul of Tarsus on his way to Damascus. And he has an encounter. And this man, who was a Pharisee, who was totally anti-Christ, suddenly becomes pro-Christ. He becomes a preacher of the gospel. And the only reason he says is, I saw Jesus. You know, Jesus spoke to me. And that was it. You know, for this man's life to be so transformed 10 years after, you know, the resurrection of Christ is evidence that Jesus is exalted at the right hand of the Father. So three simple things that I would point to, and the others are welcome to add. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Pastor. Any of the faculty would like to add to it? Thank you, Elisha, for confirming that your question has been answered. Thank you. Any others would like to, you have any questions, you'd like to share your thoughts? You can unmute and ask, or you can post it on the chat.
Pastor, just a quick question about, you know, Job, the last chapter and verse 7, like the Lord tells Eliphaz and, you know, Job's friends that his wrath is aroused because they have not spoken of him what is right, as Job has. So what should be our perspective in studying the book of Job, you know, when it comes to, we do draw like use like when we consider whatever Job's friends are speaking, do we not consider those? So I just had a thought, you know, like how do we, like Job does say many things, you know, Job 31, I've made a covenant with my eyes, and so we use all those scriptures. So how do we look at that? So
Yeah, so Job 42:7. So one thing we can quickly point out is, you know, Job had four friends and God only rebuked three of them by name. That means he left out Elihu, the youngest one. So we can read Elihu's responses with confidence because he didn't include Elihu in the list.
Right.
That's one thought. The other thing is also, it's not, you know, so these friends of Job were speaking. It's all recorded for us. Because you know, the Bible does record many things, good and bad, people have spoken or done. And they are expressing their thoughts. So not everything that they are saying is wrong. But the point that they were driving at was wrong. So these three friends of Job, when we read what they were saying, basically they were pointing back to Job and saying, Job, it is because of your sin and your unrighteousness, you're going through these things. Therefore, you need to own up. You need to, you know, get right with God. So when you read it, that's basically, it's an accusative approach that these three friends have been taking against Job. So it doesn't mean everything they've said is wrong. Some of the things are very general about God, which are true. God is righteous, God is just, and those are true. It's not that they are wrong. Yeah, they're general true statements. God rewards those who seek Him. God blesses those who seek Him. Those who seek God will prosper. These are things that they've said, and that they're true. But what were they driving at? They were driving at saying, Job, you are a sinner. You have done things that are wrong. And so in the process, Job is defending himself and appears to be actually very self-righteous, because Job says, hey, I haven't done anything wrong. I've lived right, and I have, you know, we can read all of that. So I think that's what the Lord is pointing out to, which is something Elihu didn't do. And so that's the part that, so we do read everything they said. We interpret what they said in the light of the rest of Scripture, because that tells us, you know, what is right and what is not right in what these friends of Job spoke. But I think the main thing that where they went wrong was their that they were accusing Job of what he was doing. So the answer question is, yes, we can read it. We can take the general things that are true about God and leave out, you know, the accusations. Yeah.
Right. Thank you, Pastor. Thanks.
Thank you, Pastor. Pastor, we have a question from Sister Dana saying, you use this term community laws and hygiene laws. Can you briefly define this, please?
Yeah, Dana. I don't remember like everything. Basically, we read about all of this in Exodus, Leviticus, and Numbers. I don't remember all of this, but I'll just give you representative ideas. So, for example, and these might be common sense to us, but these were actually spoken of by God. So, and I don't remember offhand the references, but so, for example, when God told, you know, if anybody wants to go to the toilet, he needs to go away from the camp and not anywhere near the camp. So that's a community law. Now, God spoke like this. He had to give them this specific instruction. But then we understand it. Hey, it's a hygiene law. It's like, okay, yeah, of course, if you want to go to the toilet, you go far away, not close to the camp. Because you're going to, you know, it's going to make things messy, and it's going to help affect the hygiene, right? So that's just one example. Or, and the kind of foods that they were going to eat. So he said, for example, don't eat animals, don't drink the blood of the animals, don't eat animals that had split hooves. So typically this would be like the pork and so on. Now today we eat pork, and you know, it's not against that, but because now we know how to raise them up and rear them up in a healthy way, in a hygiene way. And so I'm not against eating pork. I eat pork, but sometimes, but I'm just saying that those things you find them. And then, for example, he said, don't eat what we would today would be like shrimp and the sea creatures, which actually eat the dirt on the seafloor, seabed. But today, of course, we do eat shrimp. We do eat those kinds of sea creatures. But in the instructions God had given to his people in the Old Testament, these were specific things he spelled out. And and if you look at it, it's because of these reasons. These are very practical things. They were health and community law. So God didn't just say, I am the Lord your healer, live as you want. He said, I'm the Lord your healer, but follow these instructions. And that's what I was kind of getting at. The details, you know, you could read in Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers. He spells them out.
Yeah. Thank you, Pastor. Thank you, Diana, for asking that question. Okay, is we have a question from Herbert. I have a Good News Bible, but someone said it's not good to use. So he said that he can use, he said that for him, he can't use any other Bible other than KJV version. So which version would you recommend? Pastor, you'll take up this question.
Herbert is in second year, right? Herbert, you're in second year. Now, remember in one of our courses, I think we did it this semester in our apologetics course, right? We went through that, why are there different versions of the Bible? And we explained, let me just see if I can share it right now. We shared on why there are different versions of the Bible and what's the difference. Let me just bring this up very quickly. If I can share that chart. Okay. Can I have your permission, Diana, to share my screen?
One second, Pastor.
Yeah, I'll do it. I think it gives me permission.
You can do it, Pastor?
Yes.
Yes, we can. Thank you.
All right. So here's a quick thing. So we did this, Herbert, in our second year class earlier this semester. So we look at the types of Bible translations, right? So basically, why do we have so many translations of the Bible version, English translations? So we start from the left-hand side here, which is structural integrity. And then, so that's word for word. So there are word for word translations. So that's structural integrity of the text. That means they are, the goal of the translation is keep, exact word for word translation, right? Structural integrity. But then as you progress, there is thought for thought translation. That means what was the thought communicated in the text? And we will convey that same thought in our language. And then there is paraphrase, which is just make it easy for people to understand. So, we have Message Bible out here, a Living Bible, Good News Translation here, and so on. Right. So now all of these versions actually serve a purpose. That means there are people who enjoy reading paraphrase. It's very simple, modern language, everything. But actually, it's far away from this word-for-word integrity. It's not a word-for-word translation. There are people who like thought-for-thought, like the NIV, and the Passion Translation, which has come out recently, would be somewhere here in the middle. Right? They're trying to mix a thought-for-thought idea-for-idea translation, as also keep it in modern English. So it's coming somewhere here. But so if you look at the NASB and the New American Standard Bible 2020 version is one of the best in terms of being close to word for word and also at the same time trying to use modern English, right? So King James, which came out among the earliest, is somewhere here. It is word for word, but they do add additional words which are given in italics, and then the New King James. So to answer your question, Herbert, there's nothing wrong in using a Good News translation, but you understand that why that translation is done and where how far away it is from the original, but it serves a purpose. It communicates the essence of the thought and truth in modern language. But if you're a student of the Bible, if you're studying the text, you want to be a teacher and a preacher of the word, then we definitely recommend going close to the word for word, somewhere in this range, New King James, King James, RSV, ESV, Amplified, New American Standard. It's definitely good to be in this range, because then, you know, you're closer to the original text, word for word, and so on. But if there's somebody who's just, you know, I just want to have an idea of what the scriptures say here, or somebody who can, who's good in English, then we let them, you know, do, we can encourage them in IV. So there is nothing wrong in using paraphrase or thought for thought, but if you're really serious Bible study, you know, it's better to be over here. Does that help, Herbert?
Yeah, thank you so much for that explanation. I've really understood why people have different versions. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Pastor, for the deep explanation. And thank you, Herbert, for that question. We have a few more minutes. Is there any question that we could ask? We have 4 minutes left. Is there any questions? Okay, yes, there's no questions. Maybe we can wind up. Today we had some very interesting questions, and you know, and also our pastors went in deep to answer that. Thank you so much. We have a last question from Elisha saying, Pastor, can you please explain the infallibility of the word? Pastor, would you like to pick up this question?
Sure. I'm sure the other pastors can answer this. Sure. Anyone else?
Anyone?
I know it's just 3 minutes, but Pastor Jakes or Pastor Nancy, you want to take it up? Jean?
I'll just hear from you, Pastor. No problem.
Yeah, so Elisha, the infallibility of the word, that means God's word can never fail, right? God's word is unchangeable, and God's word will not fail. Because, one, it depends on the nature of God, right? Every word spoken depends on the person who spoke it. So in this case, because God spoke it, it will not fail. You know, so God cannot lie, the Bible says. So from that context, you know, we know God's word is utterly dependable. It will not fail. It will not return to him void. So that's why we can, you know, we rest our entire life on the word of God. Any particular aspect you want to look at, Elisha, very quickly?
Pastor, thank you very much. Thank you very much. How does it differentiate from the inerrancy of the word?
So the infallibility of the word depends on God who spoke the word. The inerrancy of the word is on the human side of it, which when we talk about inerrancy, we talk about the human side, which is how were the scriptures brought to us today? You know, so we have 66 books. These books were written, you know, between 4,000 some years ago on. So when we talk about the inerrancy, we are saying the human side, you know, how can we prove that the text we are reading today is the text that was originally written by whoever spoke it, by the prophets who spoke it, or the apostles who wrote it? So the inerrancy deals with the human side. The infallibility deals with the God side, which is, you know, it depends on God. So the inerrancy is on the human side. And then, so we will cover that in our course, in the second year course, where we talk about the Word of God. Why do we say the Bible is inerrant and reliable, authentic in its text? Okay, Elijah, so we'll cover it in detail in our second year course on apologetics, we cover that. But we can prove by the number of manuscripts, by the smallness of the time gap, that the Bible is one of the most authentic, most reliable ancient texts that we have, manuscripts that we have, better than any other ancient manuscript. We can prove it. There are, you know, like just there are more than 20,000 manuscripts the New Testament scriptures, thousands of 15,000 plus manuscripts of the Old Testament scriptures. The time gap is down to close to about 200 years for the Old Testament. The New Testament scriptures is less than 100 years or 50, yeah, less than 100 years. So both in the time gap and the number of manuscripts, we can prove that the scriptures are inerrant. But we'll get into it in the course on apologetics. I think we have to wrap up. So Diana, if you can
yes,
pray and send us out.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And thank you each one for taking this time to be a part of this call today. So before we could dismiss, we'll have a word of prayer. Dear God, we thank you. We praise you. We love you. We honor you. We give you thanks and praise, Lord. Thank you for this beautiful morning that you have blessed each one of us. And thank you, Lord, that you have answered and given us and clarified every doubt, every question which the students had. Thank you, Father, for opening up our thoughts, our heart and mind so that we can understand, Lord, understand from your word, the in-depth knowledge of your word, oh Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you have given this time week after week. We can set this to learn from your word and to clarify all our doubts and our questions, oh Father. Lord, I also lift up each and every student and the faculty, Lord, as we head towards our sessions. We pray that you will minister to each one and you will help us to continue to grow and study in your word, Lord. Thank you, Father. And we surrender ourselves and this time of a class in your hand. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. God bless. Thank you for joining in today's mentoring. See you all in the respective classes. Thank you. God bless.